Welcome to episode 4 of Walt Disney Animation Studios Trivia. This time we pulled something from the post-Renaissance era, Treasure Planet. Get ready to sail across the galaxy with Jim and Silver in search of Flint's elusive treasure trove and hopefully learn something new along the way. Treasure Planet is the 43rd film released by Walt Disney Animation Studios. It released on November 27, 2002. The movie was directed by John Musker and Ron Clements. Treasure Planet unfortunately flopped at the box office. With a budget of $140 million, it was the most expensive traditionally animated movie ever made at the time, and it only brought in $38 million domestically and $71 million internationally, putting it just under $110 million worldwide. The LA Times once listed Treasure Planet as one of the most expensive box office flops of all time. Treasure Planet was nominated for the Academy Award for Best Animated Feature at the 75th Academy Awards. It lost the Oscar to Spirited Away, but I mean, who was beating that? The movie was also nominated for 7 Annie Awards. Director Ron Clements pitched Treasure Planet at a session called a gong show, all the way back when he initially pitched The Little Mermaid to the studio. Of course, they took him up on his mermaid idea, and it was a huge success, changing the course of Disney animated movies. No big deal. Ron Clements and his directing partner John Musker had previously directed The Great Mouse Detective, and after The Little Mermaid, they went on to direct Aladdin and Hercules, all while keeping Treasure Planet on the back burner. It was their passion project, and fortunately their patience with the studio paid off because after a handful of very successful movies, they were finally allowed to make Treasure Planet a reality. The movie took 4 years to make, but to them, they say it really took 17 years. The movie is a science fiction adaptation of the novel Treasure Island by Robert Louis Stevenson. It's actually not the first adaptation of this story to take place in outer space, as there was an Italian miniseries released in 1987 called Treasure Island in Outer Space. By setting the film in space, they hoped to spark as much excitement in young audiences as the original novel did for kids years ago. Ron and John decided to make Jim an adolescent instead of a child, and they also made him more troubled in their movie than in the novel, as it would add depth to his character along with more room to grow. Jim Hawkins' mentor figures in the book were Squire Trelawney and Dr. Livesey, who were fused together to create the character of Dr. Doppler. They also decided to emphasize the father-son dynamic between Jim and Silver a lot more in their movie version. The narration in the film was originally told by an adult Jim Hawkins, but they changed that later on. It was Glenn Keane, supervising animator for John Silver, that suggested incorporating flashbacks of Jim's life within the I'm Still Here montage, alongside the scenes of Jim and Silver. It really helped establish Silver as the surrogate father figure in place of Jim's father who abandoned him. The scene where Silver comforts Jim and tells him he has the makings of greatness resonated with Glenn Keane because he had a similar experience with a football coach when he was 18. Originally, Scroop was supposed to die by getting hit with a freeze gun and then falling to the deck and shattering into pieces. But when the directors saw Atlantis, which came out a year before Treasure Planet, they discovered that Scroop's death was a little too similar to Rourke's death, so they changed it. It was actually better this way because Scroop suffered the same fate he caused Mr. Arrow, and that's karma.
Get wrecked, bitch.
Let's talk animation. Treasure Planet uses the technique of placing 2D traditional animation on top of 3D computer animation. Animators hope to achieve a seamless look where you wouldn't be able to tell the difference between the different mediums being blended together. It was impressive for the time, but some of it didn't age too well. As frustrating as it was for Ron and John to keep having their pitches rejected by the studio, it turned out to be a good thing because technology developed a lot in that time, and they were able to more closely match their vision for the project. Animators tried to follow what they called the 70-30 law when making the movie, meaning they wanted the overall look of the film to be 70% traditionally animated and 30% sci-fi or CGI. The technology Deep Canvas, originally created for Tarzan, was used to create what they called virtual sets for the movie. These were 360-degree sets in which they could place the camera anywhere they wanted to and maneuver it, just like a live-action movie. The sets were digitally painted, and they were able to keep that painting quality even when moving through the sets. A big inspiration for the look of the movie came from the Brandywine School painting style. It's a classic storybook illustration style, like an oil painting. They wanted a more warm, lush, and old-fashioned look for the film, rather than aiming for realism. In order to avoid the characters having to wear spacesuits and helmets for the entire movie, the concept of Ethereum was created, which was an outer space filled with atmosphere. This helped in avoiding the cold feeling of certain elements in science fiction, so along with having no spacesuits, they decided to have the ships resemble those that would sail on the sea. In order to test how a computer-generated body part would mesh with a traditionally animated character, the crew took a clip of Captain Hook from the 1953 Peter Pan movie and replaced his arm with Silver's cyborg arm. The color green wasn't used much throughout the movie because it was reserved to represent Treasure Planet, and the closer they got to it, the more green came into play. This shot of the crescent moon planet Montressor took 2 years to animate.
Wow, I'm impressed!
The supervising animator for Morph, Michael Cho, studied lava lamps as reference for the character. Morph ended up as sort of a cross between a puppy and a lava lamp. The directors joked that the characters who die do so in order of who was the most complicated to animate. Mr. Arrow was pretty tough, so he went first.
Bye bye!
Then this whole lot. Similarly, Silver's striped pants became a nightmare to animate, so the cleanup animators begged to have him not wear them for the entire movie. So around halfway through, they change. John Ripa, the supervising animator for Jim Hawkins, cited James Dean as a partial inspiration for their version of Jim, because he captured pain as well as youthful innocence. Jim is always animated with a mask of shadow around his eyes. It's a visual representation of his internal struggle, and it adds to his broody attitude and appearance. After Jim saves the day in the climax of the movie, his eye mask is gone for good. The music in the movie is mostly the orchestral score composed by James Newton Howard, although there is a notable segment featuring the pop rock song I'm Still Here, written and performed by John Resnick of the Goo Goo Dolls. The song Iris by the Goo Goo Dolls was previously used as a temporary test track over that scene, which caused the creators to reach out to Resnick about writing new material for the movie. Resnick expressed that he found it easy to relate to Jim at that age, so he was a great fit for the project. He wrote another song, Always Know Where You Are, which can be heard in the film's credits. The soundtrack version of this song was performed by B.B. Mack.
La la la.
The character of Dr. Doppler was written with David Hyde Pierce in mind. Likewise, Captain Amelia was written in hopes of Emma Thompson voicing the character. She was excited at the opportunity of playing an action-adventure character, and since she was pregnant at the time, voice acting allowed her to still play the role without having to physically do the action scenes. For the most part, none of the voice actors interacted in the making of the movie. All their sessions were done separately. But Joseph Gordon-Levitt, who voiced Jim, asked if he could interact with Brian Murray, who voiced Silver. They ended up being able to schedule some sessions with the two actors present, so they did a lot of their dialogue together, which helped the characters' relationship in the movie. Dane Davis, the sound designer for the film, provided the voice for Morph. Patrick McGowan performed his final acting role in Treasure Planet. He voiced Billy Bones. And now it's time for reoccurring Disney voice actors! Keep in mind, this is only including Walt Disney Animation Studios pictures, so I'm not including any reoccurring Pixar voice actors. There are also several voice actors in Treasure Planet who have provided tons of additional voices, or voices for extremely minor characters that I won't list because it would get very, very tedious to do so. Some of these guys have over 300 acting credits on their IMDb pages. Roscoe Lee Brown, voice of Mr. Arrow, voiced Francis in Oliver and Company. Corey Burton, voice of Onis, also voiced Grumpy in Ralph Breaks the Internet. Mr. Harvey Fenner in The Princess and the Frog. Mole in Atlantis, The Lost Empire. One of the ancestors in Mulan. Two of the Titans, the Burnt Man and the End of the World Man in Hercules. Brutish Guard in The Hunchback of Notre Dame. And Prince Ahmed and the Necklace Merchant in Aladdin. Tony Jay, narrator of Treasure Planet, also voiced Frollo in The Hunchback of Notre Dame, as well as Monsieur Dark in Beauty and the Beast. Laurie Metcalf, voice of Sarah Hawkins, also voiced Lucille Crunklehorn in Meet the Robinsons.
Sorry.
Patrick Penny, voice of Aquanigan, voiced tons of minor roles in Disney movies, but the slightly more notable ones include Fa Dang from Mulan, the Cyclops Titan Argus, as well as the Black Marketeer in Hercules.
Wanna buy a sundial?
Phil Proctor, voice of Blinko, and other pirates, also voiced numerous minor characters in Disney movies, but I think the best one he did was definitely Snowball the Cat from Hercules. Jeremy Suarez voiced the little alien kid in the movie. There was actually a scene featuring Jim and a different alien kid Suarez voiced named Ethan that was cut from the movie. Suarez was the voice of Coda in Brother Bear. Now let's talk about Treasure Planet's presence in the Disney parks across the world. This is my favorite segment that I do, but there is really next to nothing to say here, unfortunately. Disney Fan Day's inaugural party was an event organized at Disneyland Paris Studios Park. It was a fan event where the characters were given a new look, and the visitors could meet characters that they couldn't meet before at this particular park, which included Jim Hawkins. Jim has also been spotted on rare occasion in Tomorrowland in Walt Disney World. And that's it. I feel like a Treasure Planet ride could be really fun. Maybe a Space Mountain overlay? Also, the Benbow Inn could be a restaurant.
That's my opinion!
Let's finish off the video with some fun facts.
Okay.
Treasure Planet is the third Disney adaptation of Treasure Island. There was the live-action movie Treasure Island that came out in 1950, as well as Muppet Treasure Island in 1996. Treasure Planet was the first major studio movie to release in regular and IMAX theaters simultaneously. Treasure Planet had early plans for a sequel as well as a possible television series, but these were cancelled when the film disappointed at the box office. The ship in the movie is named the RLS Legacy, which is a homage to Robert Louis Stevenson, author of the Treasure Island novel. Lilo and Stitch came out in 2002, the same year as Treasure Planet. There's actually a little Stitch Easter egg in one of the scenes.
How?
These movies were both nominated for Best Animated Feature at the Oscars that year, making it the first time Walt Disney Animation Studios had two films up for the same award in one year. Unfortunately, they both lost. When Jim and Dr. Doppler arrive at the spaceport, they get directions from two characters using a ladder. These are caricatures of directors John Musker, at the top of the ladder, and Ron Clements, holding the bottom of the ladder. They often make little cameos in their movies. It started with Aladdin and continued into Hercules, and then Treasure Planet. Jim's full name is James Pleiades Hawkins. Pleiades is a star cluster located in the constellation Taurus. The animators apparently visited a Benihana restaurant to take notes for the scene where John Silver chops shrimp. You gotta get that right. Apparently, some cut dialogue from the end of the movie revealed that Dr. Doppler was the one who gave birth to his and Captain Amelia's children, but Disney wanted the lines cut because while they were aliens, it was considered too risque for a Disney movie.
Am I Pegnate? Help? Could I be Pregonate? How do I know if I'm Pregan? Pregananant?
Imagine knowing you're pregnant the moment it happens.
I think the not you trick-ass bitch.
Adam Dykstra animated the character Snuff, and he also provided the voice of the character. The farting noises this alien makes is a language called flatula.
I'm fluent in flatula, Jim. Took 2 years of it in high school.
Dykstra created these noises with something called gack, although he was always alone in the recording booth, so you never know. And with that, we've reached the end. Let me know in the comments below if you're a fan of Treasure Planet and what you like or dislike about it. I'll admit, this isn't one of my favorites, but I was glad I got to spend this time watching and researching the movie because I definitely gained some appreciation for it. The ambition and innovation alone behind the project warrants some respect. If you like this video, consider hitting like or subscribe, and if you want to see more trivia videos, you can visit the channel or I have the playlist linked in the description. I also have video essays and ranked lists on my channel, so feel free to check those out. Thanks so much for joining me on this outer space voyage to Treasure Planet. I'll see you next time.